It is good to see you all here. Would you stand and worship with us this morning? Are here to be able to praise his name in everything that we do. This morning, we're going to continue in this time of worship. And the next couple songs that we're going to play are just focusing on his goodness. And today, we're coming together as, we really are just coming together as a group of imperfect people that are just trying to point people toward a perfect God, toward a good God. And so I don't know if you're coming in like feeling that goodness or feeling super heavy, but we just want to spend these next couple moments and focus on His goodness, that He's in control, that He's got it all. So would you pray with me this morning? Lord, we thank You for that goodness. Lord, I thank You that it's not by my control, but Lord, it's only by Yours. God, I want to focus on who You are and Your goodness and not anything that I have going on, Lord, but just on Your goodness. Lord, we love You and we praise You. Amen.
Is right.
You're so good.
Celebrated Easter, and the Friday before is called Good Friday. Growing up, I always had a hard time with that idea. How can it be good? Jesus died, right? It's a dark day. It's a painful day, and when we look at the cross, we see his sacrifice. We see what he did, and honestly, as a kid growing up in the church, all I saw was my sin. All I saw was that I put him on that cross, but it's good because he paid the price for my sin. For your sin. Today we're going to partake in communion, and for a moment I'm going to ask you to go ahead and sit down. Our host team's coming forward, and they're going to begin passing out the symbols of communion. As they do that, I just want to invite you to lean in and listen to the words of the song. Feel free to sing where you are. When everyone's received those emblems, and as the host team comes now, as those are getting passed along, we'll stand again, we'll take those together, and we'll finish this day in worship, because God is so good. Jesus paid the price. The story of the cross is not just about our sin. It's about the fact that our sin is paid for, that he took our punishment on himself. And so Easter may be a moment to celebrate his resurrection, but every single Sunday when we gather together, we celebrate not only his death, but also his resurrection. So as this song plays and as the emblems are passed, when those come to you, hold on to them. One of the things I want to say is, in our church, if you are a believer in Jesus, you're welcome to partake in communion. You don't have to be a member of this church. Parents, if your kids are in the room, you know where they're at in their relationship with God. We encourage everyone, if you have a relationship with Jesus, to join in this as we remember what he's done. So go ahead, host team, come to the front, and we'll begin passing those.
Now I long to breathe the air of heaven, where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets, to look upon the one who bled to save me and walk with him for all eternity. Oh, there will be a day when all bow before him. There will be a day where death will be no more. Standing face to face with him. Desperation with songs of faith, we sing through doubt and fear. And in the end, we'll see that it was worth it when he returns to wipe away our tears. Oh, there will be a day when to face with him.
incredible to me that Jesus laid out this moment for us. He joined with his disciples on that final night. We call it the Lord's Supper. The Lord's Supper, not just communion. Is as he joined with his disciples, he had something to set up for all of us, not just for them, but for us. He would have thought of us maybe as God even today, knowing that we'd be gathered in this room to remember what he'd done. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul writes to the Corinthian church, but also to us, to talk about what communion was all about. He said, "For I received from the Lord what I also pass on to you." Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took the bread, broke it, said, "This is my body, which is broken for you." So today, this piece of bread that you hold is a representation of Jesus' broken body. And ever since I was little, some of you have heard me say this, ever since I was a little kid, there was a moment where I thought about it and I said, you know what? I'm the one who broke his body. So ever since I was a kid, I've broken that bread to remember that my sin is what put him on the cross. It was my punishment that he took on himself. And the beauty of it's not just of this is it's not just my sin, but it's ultimately what he did when he paid for it. So whether you want to break it with me or you want to hold it just as it is, I invite you to take the bread. Paul goes on to say, in the same way after supper, he took the cup, said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me." Paul goes on to say, "Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." And to a lost and dying world, as we gather in this moment and those even online, wherever we are, as we take communion today, we make a proclamation that Jesus didn't just die for my sins, that it wasn't just my mistakes that put him on the cross, but that he paid the price. He overcame death and the grave. He overcame sin, and by his blood, we are healed. This may just be a symbol, but we are reminded and we proclaim to the world our living Savior. Let's take the cup together. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we don't just celebrate Easter. We don't just celebrate your resurrection 1 week a year. Every time we gather to proclaim that you are alive. And as we take communion, Lord, would we be reminded as we go into our world, as we go into our workplaces and our schools, God, that we would carry the joy of our risen Savior with us. Not just the pain of our sin and our brokenness, but the joy and hope that comes from knowing that you have taken care of it all. So we are going to stand right now. Go ahead and join me as we stand and worship. And Jesus, we pray as we worship this in this last song, would you hear our hearts? Would we make a proclamation, not just heaven someday, but heaven here on earth. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We lift you up in the name of Jesus today.
Day we join the resurrection and stand beside the heroes of the faith with one voice, a thousand generations sing, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain."
Sing that again. And on that day,
and on that day, we join the resurrection and stand beside the heroes of the faith. And with one voice, a thousand generations sing, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain." Forever he shall. We raise a mountain.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you that we have the hope to look someday to heaven. But we also have the hope here today in this world, as broken and messed up as it can be, that there is an imminent God who loved us so much that he came into our world, that he experienced the same temptations that we experience, that he was in the middle of it just like we are day to day. Lord, we pray, God, today that we would have a better picture of all that you've done for us, not just of eternity someday, but eternity here in our hearts, heaven in our hearts, lived out for a world to see the goodness of our God. Jesus, would you be glorified in everything we do today? Not just from the songs we sing, but the smiles we share, the community that we experience here. God, would we know your goodness as we listen to your word spoken, as we give out of the overflow of our hearts. God, as we go into our world, would we carry with us the hope of heaven here on earth, the hope of Jesus alive and well right here with us. We thank you, Jesus, so we don't just have to wait someday to experience you, but we can experience you right now in this place. Lord, I lift up those today who are struggling, who are going through difficulty, whether it's in finances or relationships, whether it's school or work, whatever they're going through, would they meet you face to face today, Jesus? Would they know your love by the smiles of others in this room, by hugs and high fives, Lord? Would they experience who you are in this place? We thank you for this family. We thank you for the opportunity to be a part of what you're doing. We thank you that we are proclaiming not just your death, but also your resurrection and your life as we carry this hope into the world. We love you, Jesus. In your wonderful name we pray. Amen. Amen. And would you turn to someone around you today and let them know you're glad to see them this morning? Go give somebody a hug or a high five. Meet somebody you haven't met before. Good stuff. Good morning. It is so good to be together. I love that we're joined from all over the place. I want to say welcome back to some of our snowbirds that I see in the room this morning. If you don't know, if you're not around here, from around here, you don't know, snowbirds go, if they fly away for the winter and they come back. So some of them are coming back over these several weeks. My in-laws are coming back from Arizona soon. We'll look forward to seeing them, as well as many of you who are back. We're so glad you're with us this morning. I also want to say welcome to those who are watching online. So glad that you can be with us wherever you are. I know that we have people watching from all over the country as well as around the world, and so we love that we can be together. I think Sean and Christina might also be tuning in. If you didn't know, Sean and Christina are traveling today. Actually, they're away and part of a missions event, and so they send their love. They're so bummed to be away from you today, but I know they're getting to connect with other churches as well. I want to call your attention to a couple things that are going on around here, but first I just want to mention, in the seat back in front or behind you is our Connect card. And this is just a way to say, hey, I'm here. I was glad to be here today. If we don't have your information, you can fill that out with your first time, second time guest, or regular attender. Maybe you need to update your info because you've been away for a little while. But we'd love to have you fill that out. And then at any time during the gathering today, if God's moving your heart to take a step, whether it's in getting involved in a community and groups, if you're taking a step of salvation today, serving, baptism, you can check those boxes and just let us know. And then there's also a place for prayer requests. It was so cool last week during Easter. We got so many of these cards, and I think we had over 30, 35 prayer requests that came in as a part of these cards. It was great as a team just to get to pray over each and every one of them. And so I just want to say every week is an opportunity to fill that out, whether it's something you just want to celebrate that God's done, maybe just a prayer request, something you're going through that we can join with you. And then we do have a prayer chain of people who would love to be praying with you. So if you feel comfortable with sharing that, just write prayer chain down there somewhere on your prayer request. and we'll make sure to pass that along. So don't miss out on that. Also, in the seat back in front of you is a QR code. And if you're not familiar with QR codes, you can open up your camera app on your phone. You can scan that, and there's links to all sorts of things, including a digital Connect card and prayer card, ways to give, all the different things that are going on. You can find those on there, as well as how to download our app, all that kind of stuff. So I want to make sure you're aware of that. Speaking of the app, we have an incredible app that we've built for this congregation, for this family, as a way to stay connected. And you can scan that code directly if you'd like to. What we do is try to keep that up to date. Right now, we're adding in new events. So the events that are coming around, we're trying to get that as a part of the calendar. So if you want to know what's ahead, you can check on that anytime. There's also a Bible app built into it, reading plans, all kinds of stuff there. And so if you are part of one of the serving teams around here, you probably use that as well to get your schedule, all kinds of great ways to stay in touch with what we're doing at Whitefish Assembly. So I want to make sure you're aware of those things. Last week was Easter, and it was incredible. We had over 420 people here on Sunday, Easter Sunday, many of whom were here for the first time or first time in a long time. I believe we received something like, we had 20 different families who took one of our guest gifts. So we just love those moments. We thank you for inviting. Hopefully some of you are back from Easter last week, and we do know that it's a little bit different of experience on these normal Sunday mornings for us, but we hope that you feel welcome from the moment you walk through the doors. It was a really neat moment. We also got to give to the food bank for all the cards we received. We received over 60 cards, Connect cards, last week, and so we're excited to be able to give and make a difference there. Next week is the 14th, and we're doing something that's really important to us. We believe around here that baptism is a big deal. If you have been around here and seen baptisms, it's a celebration, it's a family party, it's just a big deal, and we have several kids and teenagers who are interested in getting baptized. We want to make sure and extend the opportunity to you as well. It's not an every week kind of thing, obviously, but if you've been thinking about taking a step and following Jesus in baptism, even if you're just interested, we'd like some more information. We'd love it if you just fill that out on your Connect card, check that box, make sure there's contact information so we can be in touch with you. And this coming Sunday, we're going to have an incredible time of baptizing and just taking that next step of transformation in people's lives. And then afterwards, we're going to have a barbecue. What better to go with life change than barbecue? I don't know. We're going to have a great time, and I encourage you to stick around afterwards and be a part of that. I do want to say, if you want to be in baptism, you can check the box on the card or on the app as well on our Connect card there. It's going to be a great week next week. So we have barbecue, BBQ, and then we also have JBQ. If you don't know about JBQ around here, it's Junior Bible Quiz. And we have an incredible kids program that believes deeply in the importance of biblical literacy, of understanding the Word of God. And you see these little ones up here, some first graders who have more memory verses than most of us memorized. And man, it's life-changing. So I want to encourage you a couple things. We get the privilege of hosting State Junior Bible Quiz this coming weekend right here in our church. So a couple things. Yeah, one, would you be praying for those kids that God would solidify the Word of God in their hearts? Also, we would love it if you have considered being a part of it, whether as a parent with your kids, a grandparent, you're looking at ways to serve. You're welcome to come Friday afternoon through Saturday. That's going to be going on. And come check it out. Go experience the fun of JBQ and what's happening. It's going to be a really neat time. So keep that in mind this coming Friday and Saturday, April 12th and the 13th. With all of these things going on, you hear about baptisms, you hear about Junior Bible Quiz. One of the big values we care about here at our church is we say we are growth-minded, that we are constantly growing and working to be more like Jesus. And so when we talk about JBQ, we talk about people taking steps of baptism, it's all about growth in our relationship with God. If you have been considering taking some steps in growing your relationship with God, we'd love to talk to you. We'd love to see you take those next steps, whatever it might look like. But I love seeing a church that says, hey, we are going to grow. We're going to continue to become more like Jesus in every way that we can. Last thing I want to say is many of you give to make all of these things happen. Not just Easter, not just our kids' programs, our youth programs. Your giving makes a difference. And if you see in the seat back in front of you, there's a giving envelope, of course. If you're a first-time guest, we never expect you to give. We don't expect anyone to give, but we love that we have the privilege of giving. I think giving is really more about, less about God needing our money, because if he needed our money, he could just take it, and there'd zap us and there'd be a greasy spot where we were sitting, right? I don't know. But he doesn't need our money. We need to give. There's something powerful about when we give, when we let go the power of money in our own lives and we see the generosity that comes out of that. And so we're growing as a church in outrageous generosity and looking forward to see more of that. All of these things that we're talking about is actually connected to this new series that we're beginning today that is really about following the way of Jesus. And we get the privilege of hearing from our very own Pastor Andy Manley as he comes today. Would you give him a hand to share the word of God?
Hey, it's good to see everybody. It's good to see everybody. I'm so excited to get to hang out and talk this morning. Like Pastor John Michael said, Sean and Christina are gone right now. They are actually, right now, they're at a missions event. They're down in Nashville, Tennessee. And they're at a missions event representing our church. They're certain within the Assemblies of God, within our denomination. They look at what our church does with missions. And they look at the generosity of this group coming together. And they say, man, can you come talk about this a little bit? Can you come talk about your church and generosity and how do you build that culture? And so they're representing us right now. We are, for kids ministry, for BGMC, we were the fourth highest giving church in the entire nation, which is insane. Yeah, you can give it up. I mean, and the celebration isn't for Whitefish Assembly, like the organization or the church or whatever. It's for all of us as a group of people that this is exciting. This is outrageous generosity. And so that's where they're at. They're in Nashville hanging out, and so they'll have a great time. I want to talk today, and if you want to start turning there to Matthew chapter 4, that would be great. I want to talk, we're going into a new series called This is the Way. And if you're newer around here, maybe you showed up to Easter last week and you're like, well, I'll try it out another week. And you're in here and you're trying to process through, like, I believe in God, but I'm not sure about this whole, like, what this means and how do I live this out. This is a perfect series to get practical tools to say, I want to learn to follow Jesus. Maybe you're in here and you've been following Jesus for years now and you would just say, man, I feel like sometimes I'm running through the motions. Nothing's bad. Like, you know, I haven't fallen off, lost my faith, but I'm just looking, man, how do I go to that next level? How do I get to know Jesus a little bit deeper? How do I grow in my faith? Like, what are some of the steps we can take no matter how long we've been following Jesus? And that's what this series is about, and I want to talk about that. This comes from Matthew chapter 4. This is the story. If you've been around church for any amount of time, you've probably come across this story. You've heard this, and this is when Jesus calls his first disciples. Jesus becomes this teacher. He becomes this, obviously, this leader that everybody is looking to, and some people think he's the Messiah, the one they've been waiting for. Some people think he's just a good teacher. Others think he's a heretic, that he is, like, against the Jewish faith, going against God. So there are all these different views, and this comes from the very beginning of that journey, as he calls this select group of guys to follow him and learn with him and walk with him. And this is what it says in Matthew chapter 4, verse 18. One day, actually, would you stand with me as we read? The first time last week I preached, or a few weeks ago, I forgot to have people stand. This week it's halfway through when I'm reading scripture, so we're making progress. This is what it says, Matthew chapter 4, verse 18. One day, as Jesus was walking along the shore of the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, also called Peter, and Andrew, throwing a net into the water, for they fished for a living. They were just fishermen out one day fishing, doing what they did. And Jesus called out to them, come, follow me, and I will show you how to fish for people. And they left their nets and followed him. A little farther up the shore, he saw two other brothers, James and John, sitting in a boat with their father Zebedee, repairing their nets, and he called them to come too. They immediately followed him, leaving the boat and their father behind. So they leave their careers, they leave their trades, they leave what they know is going to provide for them financially, and they say, we're going to follow this guy. You come to this for the first time, and you're like, that's kind of odd, right? Like, it even says they left their dad, right? He's probably like, where are you guys going? Like, are you just trying not to work hard? Now I got to do all the fishing myself, right? And they all leave, and they go to follow this guy. But in this culture, this was a normal practice. They said, I want to follow this teacher. I want to be like him. I want to walk with him. And so we're going to talk, what does that look like in 2024 in America? How do we do that same exact thing? Would you bow your heads with me real quick as we pray, as we get into this? Lord, we thank you so much for who you are. God, we thank you that you love us. We thank you that you call us on this journey. You don't just hand us a list of to-dos and not-dos. You don't just tell us, do these things and don't do these things and I'll be happy with you. God, you call us to a life of following you, knowing you, being transformed by you, and being used by you. And I pray that we would go a little deeper in that today, God. In your name, amen. You may be seated. My wife today is at home with our youngest daughter. Her name is Brinley. And last night, she gets like a fever, and we're like, oh, she must just be teething or something. Who knows? Is she sick? And then she just starts throwing up all over, like throughout the night. You're welcome for telling you that. And threw up all over my wife and then the bed. And it was just, man, a little one-year-old, and she's like the best-natured, easygoing, just loves to cuddle. She'll just be sitting there, and she just lays her head on you, and she just easygoing and fun and loves people and seeing her sick. So Kaylina is home with her, and with them is my girl that's almost 3 years old, and it's night and day difference, like personality-wise. Some of you that work in like the nursery kids and all that, thank you so much. She, like, she is the most fun. I love her so much. And her mom continually tells me, like, this was Kaylina when she was really young. Like, just personality-wise, she is this strong-willed. And I was thinking about her as I was preparing for this message. Any of you out here, you have strong-willed kids? Any of you? Any of you out here, like, you were strong-willed kids, right? Yeah. nobody wants to admit that. But I was thinking about it. It's interesting. Have you noticed we are being influenced constantly? And sometimes I don't realize it about myself, how I'm being influenced, how I'm being informed, how I'm being shaped, but I see it so clearly with my little three-year-old. She's just this strong personality. When she first, she watches these cartoons, Baby Shark, any Baby Shark families out there? Yeah, it's like collective grieving. And and so she's watching Baby Shark, and a dinosaur comes on the show once in a while, and it stomps and chases Baby Shark, right? And it started scaring my daughter. Like, it was the first moment. If you have a little kid or you've had, like, it's that moment where all of a sudden she realizes what being scared is and fear. And so at night, she would lay in her bed, and she sleeps so well. She sleeps until, like, after 8 every day. She's like a teenager already. It's awesome. She thinks she's, like, 15. And, but she started getting scared at night. And so it's like 2 a.m., and I start hearing her cry on the monitor, and I go in there, and she's just scared. And as a parent, there's that tension of, like, you want to be there for your kid and support them and encourage them, and that's my little girl, even though she's my boss, too, and tells me what to do. She's 3 years old and thinks she's my boss. But there's also the side of, like, okay, so how much support do I give and how much do I stick around so that I'm not all of a sudden creating a situation where I have to be here every single night in her room, right? It's that tension of, what do I do? So the first night it happens, I'm like, okay, do you want me to lay down on your floor next to your crib while you sleep? And she's so excited, and she says, thank you, Daddy. She doesn't pronounce the two D's, just the sweetest. But as time went on, and this happened a few more times, and her being strong-willed and her realizing that the totem pole at our house is my wife, her, me, and I've still got the youngest one for a little while longer. And so that time, so after a while, I walk into a room when she's scared, and rather than me being like, hey, you want me to lay on the floor? And her being like, thank you, Daddy. She's just got a mad look on her face, and she just points to the floor. Like, that is her. Like, she is so fun. She seems shy when you first meet her. She starts opening up. She'll show you dance moves. She's just tons of personality. And she's gotten into this movie called Trolls, some of you guys might know. And my wife and I are watching it, and we're like, why are half these jokes written towards adults? Like, and we're watching Trolls, and it's like a musical, right? And so they have Justin Timberlake as the main character singing, and then Anna Kendrick is the girl, little character. And my daughter loves it. And I started thinking about that idea of how she's being shaped and how she's being formed, because I will be sitting there with her with it on in the background, and she's repeating the lines of it. We'll start, a song will come on there from like the 80s, and she knows the lyrics. She is like a three-year-old, and she knows the lyrics to 80s songs. And I'm like, my older sisters are gonna love you, but I don't know if this is good. Like, because they're old. No, I'm kidding. I was born in the 80s. But she, and it's interesting though, because then, so I start listening to these songs. I don't usually listen to, I just not, you know, Justin Timberlake's great, I guess. I just don't listen to his music. And I start listening to some of the lyrics of these words that she is just repeating without even thinking about it. And you start to wonder, like, okay, how is she being formed? And it's not to over-worry, but you also don't want to under-worry, right? And all these messages and all these ideas and exactly what Justin Timberlake is talking about in his songs, all of a sudden my little girl is repeating them, dancing to them, and telling me to dance with her, yelling at me to dance with her. And how are we being formed? I've been introduced to this idea lately. We always think about, like, spiritual formation. We think about spiritual growth of, am I growing or am I not? And that's right, right? Like, am I moving closer to Jesus or further away? But I heard about somebody talking about it in a different way, talking about we are actually all being spiritually formed. All of us, whether we're in church, not in church, whether we've never been to church in our life, whether we belong to a different faith, whatever it is, we are all being spiritually formed. We're all being shaped in a certain direction, but the reality is, it just might not be closer to Jesus. We are all from all these different things. There's some statistics that came out. And this guy named George Barna, maybe you've heard of the Barna Group, they do all kinds of research. Now he's at Arizona Christian University. And there were some statistics that just came out about like a biblical worldview and what that is like throughout the generation. So this was in 2023, and the findings was that in America, 4% of people, just of any faith, of any life, of any whatever, 4% of people have a biblical worldview. And that isn't some intense, like, do you know what the book of Leviticus in chapter 3, verse 17 says? It's not like that. It's basic ideas from the Bible that Jesus is the way to a right relationship with God. It's that the scripture is inspired. It's kind of basic, right, that all of us are sinners and need grace. These kind of very core ideas. And 4% of America has a biblical worldview. But what's crazy is, the statistics go on, and 68% of Americans would identify with the Christian faith. You say, what, you know, not necessarily do you go to church every weekend or something, but just, are, you know, what's your faith? 68% of Americans will say, I am a Christian. But the crazy thing is, it's something like, it's either 6% or 16%. I believe it's actually 6% of that group has a biblical worldview. Which is crazy, right? And it's not to shame, it's not to say, oh, our society is just falling apart. But it is to say, even within the church, there's a discipleship issue. Like, that's just the reality. And the crazy thing is, when you start looking at generations, if you're under 30 years old, it's inside the church, I believe it's out of everyone, 1% chance that you have a biblical worldview. Now again, it's not, this isn't some like, we really just need to go scream the Bible at people so they know the story of like Adam and Eve. That's not having a biblical worldview. But it is to say, it is possible for all of us to be around the right things, to show up to church, to serve, and still not have the inner parts of who we are shaped. We've told the story a number of times since I came on staff, and it's awesome, going to church with the Madsons and Polson. But really, why that was so impactful for me was when I was a little kid, I went to church, and I adopted a lot of the right beliefs. By the time I got to high school, I wasn't going to church, and I had the right beliefs. Jesus died for my sins. I can be forgiven. He loves us. He's real. We're going to heaven. But my life looked totally different. Was not following God, was not spending time with God, was doing everything I could to try and gain the attention of other people or try and be popular or whatever, and so you follow whatever friend group it is. So I had the right belief. So that first night at youth group, when Christina was preaching about the desert seasons of our life, I felt God speaking to me saying, you've made Christianity something that it isn't. A set of beliefs, a set of ideas, a big to-do list, basically, like don't sin, be a good person, you'll get to heaven. And God's saying, I want a relationship with you. And maybe you're in here, and you would say, like, that's not me necessarily. Like, I feel like I'm doing a lot of the right things. I'm not perfect, but, you know, I am trying to follow Jesus. But maybe you're in here, and you would just say, I'm stuck. You ever felt like that? Like, I'm just stuck. Things aren't bad. Things aren't terrible. My life is okay. I'm trying to follow Jesus with everything I have, but I just feel like I'm the same person I was a year ago or 5 years ago. I still honk at people when they drive in front of me because I feel like I have a moral obligation to let them know they did something wrong, right? Like, that, like, literally, I do that, and then Kaylina has started doing that, and I'm like, oh my gosh, you're going to get in a fight. Like, she honks at people when they cut her, right? But, like, why? I still find myself being overly critical of other people and then showing up and acting like no big deal. I still find myself just being negative and frustrated and complaining. I find myself being rude to my wife when, you know, when I think something is supposed to go a certain way and she has a different plan, and I'm like, why don't you do everything that I expect us as a family supposed to do, right? Like, we're going to talk about marriage counseling next week. But, right, like, why, you know, we can do a lot of the right things and keep living in the same patterns. And so what does it look like? What is it actually like to say, Jesus, I want to follow you, yes. I want to end up in eternity with you, yes. That's awesome. But I also want to be shaped right here on earth so that I can be your hands and feet to the people around me. I heard somebody a while ago, I heard a quote that said, salvation is less about us getting to heaven, and it's more about heaven getting into us. And I get it, right? Like, obviously, salvation is about us spending eternity with God. And that's not what the quote is. But the quote is literally saying, maybe salvation isn't just about getting through this world and this life without sinning big and then going to heaven and things being perfect. Maybe salvation is about walking with Jesus in a deep, profound way that starts to shape who I am so that I can show that same exact love to the people around me who have never experienced it. Maybe salvation and discipleship isn't about just ignoring the trauma that I have experienced in the past, but it's actually about saying, God, speak into this. I need your healing so that I can move forward in these areas. Maybe salvation is about starting to be that light in our families rather than trying to change all the people around us, but starting to change within ourselves so that our families can begin to shift. That, I believe, is discipleship. That is what this is all about. In the book of Matthew, a few verses ahead, actually, I got a quote here I want to read real quick. This comes from Dallas Willard, and he wrote this book called The Renovation of the Heart, and this is what it says. Accordingly, the greatest need you and I have, the greatest need of collective humanity is renovation of our heart. It goes on and it says, that spiritual place within us from which outlook, choices, and actions come has been formed by a world away from God. Now it must be transformed. And this is one of the best explanations of discipleship that I've heard, that we are constantly being formed. We are constantly being led a certain direction. Apple is really good at forming us. They're like super strategic at how we even unwrap their packages, that it's experience and it's amazing and it's fun and it gets ingrained into our mind and emotions and we want to buy more, and then we find ourselves with like 5 Apple boxes and we don't know why we're holding on to them, right? Politics are amazing, political parties, at starting to shape us so that we then start to vote for them and see the other side as villains. Politics are amazing at shaping us. Our algorithms on our phones, right? Like what we watch on social media, it's learning. It's like, oh, this person really likes videos of people getting hurt riding mountain bikes. I'm gonna show them more. My wife sends me these amazing, like, how to raise your toddler and get them to eat well, and I send her, like, this guy that fell off this huge ramp and got hurt. And it learns social media. But here's the problem. Then once they have our attention, they are able to filter the right products towards us and the right ads to get the sale, right? So it's specifically the algorithms through Instagram and Facebook are forming us in a certain direction. The question isn't just, are we growing in our faith or not? The question is, what am I being formed to? Who am I being formed more like? And Jesus tells this story. And I talked about a little bit when we were in the whole like rebranding and recasting vision, but I want to read the actual verses here. This comes from Matthew chapter 13, 3 through 13. And Jesus is talking to a group of people, and he talks in parables, right? He'll talk in a story, and a lot of times the people wouldn't understand the story. His disciples are like, we have no idea what you're talking about. And then he sits aside with them, and he will explain the story. And this is what he says. He told many stories in the form of parables, such as this one. Listen, a farmer went out to plant some seeds. As he scattered them across his field, some seeds fell on a footpath, and the birds came and ate them. So he's talking about, and he'll get into this in a second, but he's talking about when we come to faith, what happens next. Other seeds fell on shallow soil with underlying rock. The seeds sprouted up quickly because the soil was shallow, but the plant soon wilted under the sun. And since they didn't have deep roots, they died. Other seeds fell among the thorns that grew up and choked out the tender plants. Still, other seeds fell on fertile soil. And they produced a crop that was 30, 60, and even 100 times as much as had been planted. Anyone with ears to hear should listen and understand. So he tells this story, and he talks about seed falling on the ground. Some's going to fall on good soil, some bad soil, some's going to grow some's going to grow a lot, some's going to just totally wilt. And then his disciples are sitting with him and they're like, we have no idea what you're talking about, Jesus. Like, we don't know what this like parable means. So then Jesus goes on, and in verse 18, he starts to explain it to him. And I think this is huge for us as the American church, but just the church in general, to say, what does discipleship look like? We can blame all kinds of things, whether it's the way we do church, is it, you know, just trying to get people in the door without helping them grow, or it can be, oh, we're so focused on helping people grow that people aren't coming in the door, so they never, you know, we can blame all kinds of things. We can blame culture, we can blame political parties, we can blame all kinds of things, but I think the important thing for us as believers is to say, how are we being formed, and what are we going to do going forward? And so Jesus explains what's going on, and this is what he says. His disciples came and asked him, why do you use parables when you talk to the people? He replied, you are permitted to understand the secrets of the kingdom of heaven, but others are not. To those who listen to my teaching, more understanding will be given, and they will have an abundance of knowledge. Then he says this, but for those who are not listening, even that little understanding, they will be taken away from them. That is why I use these parables. For they look, but they don't really see. They hear, but they don't really listen or understand. He goes on. Perfect. Amen. Amen. My bad, tech team. Okay, so this is what Jesus says. Do we have that next slide that lays out the three kind of errors that happen? Jesus points out three different groups in this package, or in this passage. He says there's a lack of understanding. He talks about when the seed is scattered along the ground, and the birds come and steal the seed away. So they were enthusiastic. They were excited. Sometimes when we come to faith, right, we all, maybe we've been there, or we know somebody that's so excited, but just struggled to understand the basic idea. And then it says the enemy comes and steals it away. A lack of understanding can steal our discipleship and our faith away. The second that he talks about in here, he says they don't have deep roots. He said there was a shallow soil with rocks underneath. And so the plants actually sprung up. Like, sometimes in our faith, we get excited and we start to grow, but then life happens. Then the storms come. Then we show up to a class in college where the professor is asking a really difficult question about faith and the timeline of the earth and evolution or whatever it might be, and we say, I don't have the roots to answer this effectively. Maybe I don't know what's true. Maybe the storms of life come up and we start saying, man, I don't know if this whole faith thing is going to work. It doesn't. Why would I be going through these hard moments if God was supposed to rescue me? And so Jesus tells the story that there are some of us who will start to grow, but all of a sudden there isn't a depth. There isn't a discipleship. There isn't an intimacy with Jesus that is going to hold us through those hard times. And then there's a third group that just basically says, you got sidetracked. He mentions two things, wealth and worry. Anxiety of life, maybe you get caught up trying to get ahead financially so much that that becomes the main priority. And so Jesus basically in this story tells these people, there are going to be some of us who decide to follow Jesus and all of a sudden run into hard things and stop. We feel like we push up against something. And the tension that I was wrestling with this message, so often we preach these messages and the application is really simple, right? It's just, hey, do better, okay, all of us, right? Like, I need to do better. And then I feel convicted because I'm not doing better. And then it's like, can I tell, you know? And it's like, what is, you know, like what? So often we preach like, you know, discipleship is so important, so don't sin and read our Bibles more. That's kind of the takeaway. That's not bad. That's pretty good life advice, really. But if we're in here and we're saying there has to be more, there has to be something on the inside that changes in us rather than just our own outward works. And what I love about Jesus' interactions and what I love about Jesus' interactions with those disciples when he first called them, he says, come, follow me. He was giving them an invitation. He wasn't saying like, hey, you guys are fishermen, good job, try harder, show up to the synagogue more, and you will find God. He doesn't say that. He actually says, hey, I want you to actually be my best friends, and I want you to walk with me, and I want you to follow me, and I want to start to do life with you. That what if discipleship isn't so much about just, hey, I need to read my Bible more, I need to pray, I need to not sin, and then I will be a better Christian, right? And then it's just all personal, like, ah, I got to work hard. When I first gave my life to Christ, in that youth ministry years ago, I came to this amazing realization that God's grace is bigger than my past and that Christianity is about a relationship, not a set of rules, right? But the crazy thing is, it's not like that moment, all of a sudden I was on a completely new trajectory. I was, but I still wrestled with unforgiveness of myself. I still wrestled with trying to earn God's grace. I still wrestled with the intellectual side of how could God forgive me and love me even when I'm not perfect, right? And so discipleship is this invitation from Jesus saying, come and walk on this new path. The early Christians were called followers of the way. Maybe I believe our youth ministry actually used to be called the way, youth ministry. This is the way, right? The Mandalorian. Shout out to Star Wars. Anyways, but Christian actually ends up in the Bible very few times, right? Maybe you've heard this, that Christianity, when people would call them Christians, it was actually a negative slang. It was those are those Christians. And all throughout in the book of Acts, and you see it in Paul when he's talking, that they were called followers of the way. Not necessarily Christians, that's not a bad term, but in those days, that was slang for a negative thing. They were called followers of the way that this early group of, they thought they were just these radical people following God and getting away from the Jewish Old Testament faith, and they were getting sidetracked by this Jesus guy. They were called followers of the way, and that Greek word a lot of times means a path, a journey, that the early believers were on a different path. A path of turning the other cheek and loving your neighbor when everybody else wants to overthrow the Roman government. A path of radical love to enemies who they were supposed to hate. A path of inner peace even when their country was being oppressed and controlled. they were selling their property to take care of each other. They were spending time together. Like, how radical is that? They lived in community. That was what it meant to follow the way. So I wonder if discipleship isn't so much just a, hey, these are the American ways to be a better Christian, read our Bible, pray. That's great. We need to do that. But what if it's more of actually just following Jesus through those things? In that passage that we just read, and we're going to close here in a second if the worship team wants to come up. But what's interesting to me about that passage, when you look at like the Jewish schooling, we talked about JBQ, and they've memorized verses. Is there anybody in here that you were like great at memorizing things? Great at memorizing things for a test? Yeah. Anybody not great at that at all? Yeah. The Jewish like school system in that day, when you were a little kid, your first like order of going to school wasn't learning like math and science and English, obviously. It was going to the synagogue and learning the Old Testament. That's what they had. And so they would actually show up and they would go through different verses and different key passages, and there would be a teacher there. He would be called the rabbi, and he would teach them the Old Testament. And so the school system was literally going there, learning the Old Testament, that the Jewish culture said this is the most important thing we can do. And so that was the application. And then what they would do is, by the time they got to 14, right around 14, people think, 13 or 14, if they were like the best of the best students, the best of the best, they would get to go on and potentially be a rabbi, or like for 99% of them, they would just go into the family trade. And at this point, when they're around 14, if they could keep making it all the way through, they would have, some people think, roughly the entire Old Testament memorized. Like, that's literally what they did. Period 1 through 7 in school was like, I'm just going to go and memorize scripture and memorize theology. And so can you imagine, like, memorizing an entire chapter of the Bible, let alone the entire Old Testament? Like, it's insane. And so a lot of these kids, they would get to this age, and we find Peter at this point in his life, and maybe a few years had gone by, but he was a fisherman. He fell back to the family trade. Maybe some people were carpenters, construction, whatever it may be, you would go into the family trade and you would go. And so it's kind of crazy when we read this passage, it's like, why did you just leave your father and your trade and your income to follow a guy you didn't know? And chances are they knew there's something different about this guy. People were already talking about him. This is who we're waiting for. But there was also the sense of all of these people, Peter, James, John, saying, I get a second chance at being a rabbi. When he comes and says, come follow me, they're thinking, wait, I have a chance to do that? I have a chance to be a follower. This is what it says. I want to read it one more time. Chapter 4, verse 18. And this is what it says in Matthew. Those very first verses. One day, as Jesus was walking along the shore of the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, also called Peter, and Andrew, throwing a net into the water, for they fished for a living. Jesus called out to them, come, follow me, and I will show you how to fish for people. And they left their nets at once and followed him. Jesus didn't say, you guys need to go back to the synagogue and you need to read scripture harder. And I'm not trying to make reading scripture the bad thing, because obviously they took what they knew and he showed them how to read it in a new way. But I guess what I'm trying to say is that I wonder how often we rely on our own efforts and we feel guilty that we're not doing enough. And Jesus says, I have a path that I want you to follow. And those disciples walked with him. That was the way of the Jewish school system. If you were the best of the best and the rabbi finally allowed you to follow him, you would travel with him. You would sleep where he slept. You would learn what he learned. You would, his practices maybe of spirituality and prayer and all those things, you would learn from him. And then when you got to around 30 years of age, if it was time, you could go be a rabbi yourself. And this was the beginning of what it meant to be a disciple. So when Jesus says, go make disciples, he
He isn't just saying, go like tell people about Jesus. He's saying, go do what just happened to you. Go do that with other people. Go walk with people. Go talk with them. Go answer their hard questions. And I'm going to be with you as you do it. We're going to, in the course of these next few weeks, we're going to be going through kind of just a framework, and there's this book that we've kind of been processing through as a team. It's called Practicing the Way, and we're not using it for the series or anything big like that, but there is a good framework that it'll follow of what it means to follow Jesus as far as like a practical, how do we actually do this? And we're going to be walking through that in the coming weeks. The first thing we're going to be talking about is what is it like to be with Jesus? The disciples walked with him, learned from him, talked with him. They were just with him. How do we read scripture? What book do you start with? How do we interpret some of these hard passages? The second thing we're going to talk about is how do we become like Jesus? How do we be shaped on the inside, the things we struggle with, the hard questions we have about faith, the maybe patterns that we inherited from our family that aren't healthy? How do we begin to allow God to transform us? How do we become like Jesus? And the third thing is how do we do what Jesus did? He walked around loving people. He walked around caring about people, loving his enemy. What does that look like? That's what we're going to be talking about. But right now, as we're just closing up, and if you would stand with me real quick, we're just going to go into one song. And here's the application. After all of that, here's the application. Is where are we at in our own like discipleship journey? I know for myself personally, I am so busy right now, and I wake up early, and Blake likes to sleep until 8-something, and our other daughter likes to wake up at 6-something and play, and trying to find, and then I go to work, and then I come home, and it's all these things, and trying to find that time alone with God has never been more challenging, and I find myself running through the motions and making excuses, right? We all, like, what is it for you? Maybe you're in here, and you would say, man, I'm totally new to this, and I don't even know the first step to take. Maybe you're in here and you would just say, I want to follow Jesus. And that's your step today. As we worship, just telling Jesus, Jesus, forgive me for my past. Forgive me for what's held me away from you. I want to follow you. Maybe it's saying, God, I feel stuck and I just want you to show me the path forward. Maybe you're in here and you would just say, I've lost some of my excitement. And Jesus, I want to accept your invitation and start walking closely with you. We're going to go into a song of worship and then be dismissed, but would you bow your heads with me one more time as we pray? God, we thank you for who you are. God, we thank you that you are a God of grace and you are a God of compassion and you are a God who wants to take our struggles and what we're going with and meet us in the middle of all of that. God, we thank you that we don't have to figure things out and then come to you, but right now in this moment, wherever we're at, that you can meet with us, you can change us, you can transform us. So God, we pray that you would do that.
You reign above it all, you reign above it all. Over the universe and over every heart, there is no high in vain. Jesus, you reign above it all. Let all of heaven and the earth erupt in song. Sing hallelujah to the everlasting one. There is no high in thee. Jesus, you reign above it all. Yes, you reign above. Sent the darkness running out of an empty grave. Now seated in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave. Now seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave. Now seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave, now seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave, now seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. Aren't you thankful? You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave, now seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You reign above it all, you reign above it all, over the universe and over every heart. There is no higher name, Jesus, you reign. Sing hallelujah to the everlasting one. There is no higher name, Jesus, you reign above it all. Yes, you reign above it all. Yes, you do. Oh, you reign above it all. Sing, you reign. Jesus, you reign above it all. Let all of heaven and the earth erupt in song. Sing hallelujah to the everlasting one. There is no higher name. Jesus, you reign above it all.
If you're in here and you would just say, man, I want to take that first step. I want to start following Jesus. There's nothing super spiritual about filling out a Connect card, but it is an opportunity. If you want to talk with someone and just say, I want to learn more about this thing, you can fill that out on the card. That would be amazing. Somebody from our team's going to reach out. But we're going to start this series, and we're super excited for where we feel like God's taking us. But that's what it's all about, saying, Jesus, you reign. Jesus, this is all about you. Jesus, reorganize my life around your ways. As we close here today on our way out, as John Michael has talked about, if you have any prayer requests, if you are looking to get more involved around here, maybe you showed up for Easter and you want to get more involved here, there's a number of ways, groups, serving, all kinds of community options that we would love to connect with you about. If you want to fill out a connection card and put it in the box in the back, that would be great. Next week, we are having baptisms and a barbecue, so it's something for all of us. Maybe not a vegan option. So, but there will be salad. You're right. Something for all of us. But if you want to take that next step in your faith, and you say, I've decided to follow Jesus, but I've never made that next step, that public declaration, man, baptism is such an amazing opportunity for all of us to celebrate. We're going to have food outside, all kinds of stuff going on. We would love to see you next week. I'm going to pray one more time, and we'll be dismissed. Lord, thank you for who you are. Thank you for being with us here today. We pray that you would meet us in moments throughout this week, that we would slow down, God, to hear your voice in the craziness of life. In your name, everybody said, amen. Hey, have a great rest of your Sunday.
Hey everyone, I'm John Michael. I just want to say thanks so much for tuning in and joining us at Whitefish Assembly online. I love that we can be the church, we can be a church family wherever we are, and I hope that you felt welcome all throughout this time. A couple things to remind you about is you can connect with us online at whitefishassembly.com. If you'd like to fill out a connect card, just go to whitefishassembly.com/connect or /prayer for the prayer card. And of course, if you'd like to give, you can do that at whitefishassembly.com/give. Your giving makes a difference. We love that you are part of the family here at Whitefish Assembly, and we look forward to seeing you back here next week at the same time. God bless.